Greetings. It's good to see all of you. Thank you so much for joining us for this lecture by Professor Miranda Fricker. As I'm sure you all know, Professor Fricker is professor of philosophy at the University of Sheffield, although it is also the case that she is coming across the pond to these shores, so she'll be at the CUNY Graduate Center starting next fall. So a new adventure on the horizon. Her research is mainly in moral philosophy and social epistemology. And as you know, she's the author of a book called Epistemic Injustice, Power and the Ethics of Knowing. She, in addition to her philosophical work on social epistemology, epistemic injustice, epistemic contribution, and so forth, also works in a practical domain. She serves as moral philosopher on the Spoliation Advisory Panel, which is a UK government body of expert advisors that considers claims concerning loss of cultural property during the Nazi era. So she is a philosopher who does exactly what we are interested in here at the Edmund J. Safra Center, figuring out how to take the work we do in philosophy, in ethics, in moral philosophy, into practical contexts where people are making hard judgments. And where the philosopher has, hopefully, we all hope, something to contribute to making those judgments of superior quality. So it's a great pleasure to introduce her. You all know her work, I'm sure, and I admire it for its lucidity, but also for its emphasis on relational equality and for the clarity with which she articulates views that help us understand the relationship between relational equality and distributive equality. So I take Professor Fricker to be at the forefront of work in ethics and moral philosophy that has great import for political philosophy as well. And I think her contributions have been exceedingly valuable. So enough from me. Her talk today is entitled Constructions of Forgiveness. So Miranda.
Thank you so much, Danielle. I'm so thrilled to be invited. Thanks very much for having me and indeed for coming along. I'd like to present some of the main ideas I have about forgiveness that are part of a book project that I'm working on. Can I just check that I'm sounding okay and not sounding strangely echoey? Okay, wonderful. The project I'll need to describe to you a little bit is a project inspired by a long-standing interest I have in state of nature explanations of things. And the two books that inspire me most in this connection, I think, are one by Edward Cray called Knowledge and the State of Nature, where it's the concept of a knower, which is being explained through asking what role does it play in our lives. And also a book by Bernard Williams, Truth and Truthfulness, where he's asking about the virtue of truthfulness and what role does it play in our lives. And something both those books have in common is the state of nature method. Indeed, Williams is very directly inspired by Craig's work in this regard. Is that what the method does is, I think, fairly unique as a philosophical method in that it invites us to separate out features of X, where X might be a concept or a practice, which look more or less necessary, perhaps humanly necessary, not metaphysically necessary, but necessary in the sense that they are bound to be part of any recognizable human society because, for instance, they arise directly out of absolutely basic human needs, or because perhaps they arise directly out of absolutely basic human emotional interactions. In the case of Craig's book, which I think I perhaps should explain a little bit just to for those of you who are unfamiliar with it, just to get the method going, he asks us to imagine a state of nature, a minimally social society, and we ask, what are the most basic epistemic needs that come up in such a society? And he says, well, human beings will need to have enough true beliefs and not too many false beliefs so that they can survive well and flourish. So basic information needs to be gathered and, as it were, filtered out from bad information. Now that basic need, deriving from the imperative of survival, gives rise to, very quickly, to two further immediately derivative needs. One is to be able to pool the information, because I'll survive a lot better if I'm relying not only on my own eyes and ears, but the eyes and ears of others in my community. And therefore, the ability to discriminate between good and bad informants. So the fundamental position of the epistemic subject in this scenario isn't how do I know that I, how do I really know that P? It's who can tell me whether P? I'm in a situation of ignorance. I need to be able to distinguish those of you who will tell me what I need to know. And that will involve your having a certain sort of competence and, for short, a certain sort of good motivation towards me, no motivations to deceive me or to withhold and so on. And those basic needs for Craig give rise to the notion of a good informant, which he then relates in a rather complex way I won't go into, to the concept of a knower. So any human society is bound to construct a concept of a good informant and thereafter to have some version of the concept of a knower at work in that society. And this is meant to be derived from those very basic needs alone. And in that sense, it's necessary. So that's the sort of necessity that we are dealing with here, necessity that grows out of practical implications. William's treatment of state of nature has a slightly different tenor, though effectively it's the same. He too is particularly concerned to isolate that which is necessary, and he runs Craig's epistemic story fairly along very similar lines, the need to pool information and so on, but he's casting it more in ethical terms, and he's observing that in any human society, the proto-virtues of accuracy and sincerity are bound to arise. And putting those two together, we have a kind of proto-virtue of truthfulness, which is bound to arise, just again, out of these same basic epistemic needs that Craig was dealing with. So that's the kind of necessity that Williams is concerned with. But in his book, his interest is less in the necessity and more in the contingency thereafter. So what he observes is, although it may be true that any recognizable human society is bound to have some kind of proto-virtue of truthfulness at work in it, accuracy plus sincerity, everything thereafter is contingent. Quite what form that virtue takes in relation to other values in the society, how it's understood to relate to a conception of the self, for instance, whether it's, as is played out in William's view in 18th century France, it's closely related to a notion of essential self and authenticity, or whether in fact it's thought of in a purely sort of functional way. These things are entirely historically and culturally contingent. And that's an emphasis we find in Williams, but not so much in Craig. And I want both. What I love about this method is that we're encouraged to plump for a hypothesis about a modest kind of necessity and then encouraged to think of our practices that have grown out of those basic necessary features as subject to revision, as practices we should take responsibility for and subject to critical analysis. And so I think when one tries to philosophically explain or illuminate a concept or a practice, and in my case it's here today, it's going to be forgiveness, through this method, it actually helps us be in a certain way more autonomous or encourages us to be more autonomous and take more critical responsibility for the forms, the contingent forms that our practices of forgiveness take. Because we've been brought to be aware that while a basic version of it may be necessary, quite what form it takes and how it relates to other of our values is contingent and therefore something we can change if we want to. And that's a sort of very typical, I suppose, critical theoretical moment where you realize something that seemed given, something that seemed necessary is in fact largely contingent, and that encourages us to subject it to criticism. An example, just to flesh out a little what I mean, of the ways in which a practice of a moral practice, in this case of blame, might be historically contingent, is given in a rather interesting book by Patrick Coleman, who's a historian of French literature, who argues that he's talking about moral anger. It's a book called Anger and Gratitude in 18th century France. And he argues that around in the 18th century, as more and more Enlightenment ideas were being born, practices of expressing public anger at perceived slight, so it's what I would prefer just to call the expression of blame feeling, so we stay generic, but in his case he's thinking specifically about anger, were the confine of noble men. But at a certain point, as more Enlightenment attitudes got going, they stopped being just the confine of noble men, and men who were not of noble birth but who'd won a certain sort of social standing through skills of craftsmanship increasingly were able, or as it were, permitted to express anger at perceived slight, blame feeling towards a noble man, and without being met with derision or with or being slapped down. And so they were kind of allowed into the circle of moral equals, if you like, who could express these sorts of moral attitudes one to another. Whereas, he argues, women, even noble women on the whole, apart from perhaps in certain fairly confined contexts of sexual morality and so on, and less noble men and certainly children, if they tried to express this sort of moral anger or blame feeling, they were often met with derision or were simply slapped down. So that's the kind of picture of the contingency, the cultural contingency of the forms of a moral practice that I'm interested in ultimately exposing. Though I must admit today I'm going to be focused much more on the necessity bit, and we'll see how we go. So, in order to get us going, this talk really has three parts. I'll say a little bit more about the methodology, and then I'll need to give you a kind of potted version of some work of mine on blame, only far enough to show how it's going to dovetail with the more substantive work I want to do today with you on the nature of forgiveness. So forgiveness will be the third part. So now, what's my method going to be? I've said some things about state of nature, genealogy, and perhaps some of you might think it's a bit odd putting those two things together. I should explain that although many people rightly think of genealogy as a word that indicates a tradition where there precisely are no origins, there is no state of nature, and in a sort of Nietzschean and especially Foucauldian vein, the thought would be, you know, there is nothing that's necessary, all is historical contingency. I'm going to allow myself to use the word in the same way that Williams does, and where we cast state of nature stories as that special type of genealogical story which does posit something necessary at the beginning, does posit a state of nature, does posit some sort of original set of needs or emotions which get the whole thing going and remain at core in the practice as it becomes played out in its various contingent cultural iterations thereafter. And what I think many people find rather problematic about state of nature genealogies is that they just seem like you've made it up, to put it. And sometimes they have aspects of genuine history as non-state of nature genealogies will. Think of Nietzsche's genealogy of morals, where it sort of purports to be historical. It seems to be telling historical, but it's certainly not what any historians recognize as proper history. It's kind of semi-made up history with some touching on real history here and there. So it's still more problematic. We don't even know what sort of a story this is. It's partly made up, partly historical. And when it's got a state of nature in it, it's clearly not historical. So what is it? Now, I personally think we can defend entirely coherently what this method is. So I don't want to disown it. But I am really interested in the possibility that if we understand exactly how it's meant to work and exactly what its explanatory payoff is meant to be and derive from, perhaps we can have that same explanatory payoff without all the fictionalizing that understandably, if not necessarily, puts a lot of critics off. So I would like to see if we can reinvent state of nature genealogy by, in a way, doing it in a much more transparent way in real time in the now. Now, that's why I've emphasized already to you that the way it really works, certainly in both Craig and Williams, who I think are entirely clear about what they're doing, is that there is a claim about what is necessary in the practice X, whether it's a practice of using the concept of knowledge or a practice of using the value of truthfulness, which is meant to be still true in the now. As Craig rather usefully puts it, the proto-concept of a good informant is still present at the core of our real-time concept of a knower. And same, although less explicitly, in Williams. Williams is committed to the idea that the proto-virtues of accuracy and sincerity, which are necessarily encouraged in the state of nature, are still there in anyone's concept of truthfulness, whether it's the 18th century French one that's connected up with notions of real authentic identity, or whether it's someone else's merely more functional everyday version of it. The core of the virtue is still going to be the two proto-virtues of accuracy and sincerity. So they're both working with that particular model where you've got core features of a concept or practice and then peripheral features. Now, some of the peripheral features which accrue in a particular cultural context might be very close to core, very nearly necessary, but not quite. And so we have a kind of continuum of it, of decreasingly necessary features, if you like. Now, if that's what they're doing, and I think it is, why can't we just do that without the fictionalizing? Why don't we just say, well, I'm going to come up with a hypothesis. Supposing I'm interested in the practice of forgiveness. I think, well, I want to ask, well, let's see if this method works. What, if anything, is a good candidate for the basic or core, or as I'm going to put it, paradigm case of forgiveness? Of all our practices of forgiveness that we operate with, what's the paradigm kind of forgiveness? Many people use the word paradigm in different ways. I don't mean just a clear case of, or the most common case of. I mean the explanatorily basic version, in the sense that it has a certain necessity to it in the same kind that others might posit in the state of nature. What kind of forgiveness can us human beings just not help but do because of the nature of our moral emotions? That's going to be the question. And then, so I'll put that hypothesis on the table, and then I want to ask, what point does that kind of forgiveness have? What role does it play in our lives? That's Craig's question, right? What function, if you like, does it have? I prefer the notion of what role does it play, because function sounds a little bit sort of reductive and social scientific, and I'm doing something a bit more rough and ready than that. But what does it do for us? And then we can stand back once we see what it does, and we've kind of fuzzed up our eyes away from particular moral motivations, but just see how a particular practice of forgiveness is functioning for us. Then we can ask, do we like the particular form that it's taking? Could it take a slightly different form, perhaps a less censorious or less demanding form? And so our critical capacities can then kick in at that point. But all I will have done so far is just put a hypothesis on the table. What's going to provide the argument that will, as it were, support it or show that it wasn't such a great paradigm candidate after all? Well, that's all going to depend on how much explanatory work it can do for us. And in the case of forgiveness, we meet a moral phenomenon and indeed a philosophical literature that could do with quite a bit of explaining, because there seem to be two really very different practices in moral life and as discussed in philosophy, both of which are called forgiveness, but which look quite different. One I'll call moral justice forgiveness, but many people have slightly different names for it in the literature. It involves a stance of demand on the part of the forgiver, so that she expects as a precondition and justification of her forgiveness that the wrongdoer express her remorse, or perhaps in the form of an apology, for what she's done. And that expression of remorse is a necessary precondition for the forgiveness being justified. It's certainly a precondition for it being earned. And so this style of forgiveness, which I think we all recognize, and some people think it's the only proper kind of forgiveness, we can think of as earned forgiveness. It's a sort of moral desert conception of forgiveness. And yet, there's a quite different practice that I think we all equally recognize as a clear case of forgiveness, and that other writers write about, which is, I'm going to call it unearned forgiveness. It's when forgiveness is simply a gift, and the whole point about its value, its special sort of value, is that it's unearned, and that the wrongdoer, you know, may have done something really morally shabby, and I'm aware that I ought to be apologizing and somehow making up for it, and yet my friend forgives me anyway, just for free. And the fact that it's for free, as it were, surprises me, because I think of it as the sort of thing which is intrinsically supposed to be earned, but I have not yet earned it. And that generosity of spirit and that gifting of forgiveness when it has not been earned is another clear case of forgiveness I hope you'll recognize from everyday life and from certainly different traditions. I think Christian traditions of forgiveness have both kinds. There's the more, it's sort of an Old Testament, New Testament kind of difference. It's the demand for repentance, or it's the loving Christ forgiving anyway on behalf of God. We see both traditions there. But they really are extraordinarily different moral stances, one of demand, one precisely of non-demand. So how come they are the same thing? Now, if my paradigm-based explanation of forgiveness turns out to be able to give you a plausible explanation of how those two apparently very different sorts of forgiveness really are of a unified kind, where we can show that one of them plausibly is more explanatorily basic than the other, and actually I'm also going to suggest that certain things about its meanings show that the one must have come before the other, though that's not a necessary feature of explanatorily being more basic, but in this case it will be. Then I hope that will have given you the retrospective argument and support to show that this was quite a good hypothesis, that it looks like a good bet, after all, to think that one kind of forgiveness is the basic paradigm which comes before the more contingent cultural iteration of it. So in a sense, it's a funny kind of philosophical method because the real argument comes afterwards. It's a bit like science. You put a hypothesis out there and then try to show that it's true. So that's how I'll proceed. Now, that's the end of the method bit. Now what I need to do, purely in order to get us to a place where I can do the work on forgiveness, is to give you a sort of potted version of some work I did on blame, trying to apply just this method to blame. But I really won't be pretending to offer you arguments at all about the blame bit, not even retrospectively, because I can't get there that fast. So let me just present to you some ideas about what the point of blame is that we'll then go on to use to do some proper arguing about the point of forgiveness and about how we think about these two apparently very different kinds of forgiveness that need explaining and unifying. Now, in connection with blame, I've asked, what's the point of blame? What's the paradigm? Sorry, let's ask first, what's the paradigm case of blame? What's a plausible hypothesis about the basic kind of blame? And I've argued that a plausible hypothesis is that the basic or paradigm case of blame is communicative blame, where you wrong me or hurt me, I respond with a communication that I find fault with you for what you've done, plus a little bit shot through with some sort of emotion of a kind that's going to shock you a little bit into taking notice of me. Often it will be anger, but it need not be anger. In fact, I'm of the school of thought, I don't really think there is a distinctive emotion that is blame feeling at all. Many people think that anger is a kind of necessary aspect of blame. Some people more or less identify blame with anger. I don't. It seems to me that you can blame someone for something angrily, or you can blame them just with disappointment or with some hurt or with some sadness. In fact, I think you can blame someone without any emotive content at all. But communicative blame, as I'm artificially describing it, does need to be accompanied with some slightly sort of stinging emotion designed to jab the person into recognizing that he's hurt you. So you can see how this conception of communicative blame grows pretty immediately out of Strawsonian reactive attitudes. The idea that, you know, somebody shoves me, stands on my foot, or it's standing on my hand, isn't it? I'm forgetting which is his basic example. And I respond by kind of saying, hey. I react with some kind of moral version of resentment, perhaps indignation. But as I've said, I rather doubt there is a particular emotion that goes with it. And it's all designed to do what? Well, what function it has, I've argued, is to inspire or prompt the wrongdoer to recognize the wrong that she's done you. So you're trying to get her, sort of jab her into recognizing the moral significance of what she's done to you. And that I articulate in terms of a conception of remorse, which is a sort of moral cognitivist conception of remorse, so that you recognize from Aristotle, the thought is, I don't really count as fully acknowledging the moral wrong that I've done you unless I'm feeling the appropriate pangs of remorse. So it's a kind of pained recognition of the wrong that I've done you that's required for it to be the full cognition. It'll be quite good often, not bad going if you can get someone to just recognize intellectually that they've done you a wrong, but the full moral awareness will require some sort of emotional pain, the pain of remorse. I think it's important that we don't conflate this aim of the practice either with what's in the motive of the blamer. I'm sure that very often we blame each other and we have no such motives. But we're standing back and we're looking at the rationale of a certain sort of practice that looks like a good bet for something we'll want to vindicate, something that's morally useful. And we also shouldn't conflate it with retribution. I often have trouble, I get confused thinking about what exactly is retribution, what is punishment. People use the concepts in slightly different ways. Quite possibly it's a generic sort of punishment. But if retribution always involves a certain sort of hard treatment that is construed purely as a matter of coming out of moral desert, that because you've done the wrong, you deserve to suffer to some proportionate extent, then that's not what I'm advocating here, because that sounds like any old suffering. The kind of suffering that I'm suggesting communicative blame aims at, and rightly so, is specifically only the kind of suffering that's involved in remorse. And so insofar as people use the word retribution to mean something a bit more generic, that's a bit more like revenge, then I don't want to identify the aim of communicative blame as something retributive. But of course it's awfully close. And one could think that retributive practices are a kind of rough approximation to what communicative blame aims at, since it's so often in life really hard to get people to come to acknowledge the full significance of what they've done. So a kind of close proxy for it that the state might well be justified in going in for is a kind of retributive hard treatment that remains proportional. But I leave that to others to think through. Okay, so when we ask... So we've got this idea that paradigm case of blame is communicative blame, where that's understood as having a certain sort of point, namely to inspire remorseful shared moral understanding, an alignment, if you like, of the moral understandings of the hurt party and of the wrongdoer. Now, of course, if you wrong me and I respond with communicative blame, the aim of that practice might well be immediately to get you to see things more from my perspective. But of course it won't stop there. It's not that that's always the end of the conversation. I might have communicated my blame to you and then you come back with me and you say, don't be ridiculous, you're making a huge deal out of absolutely nothing. It really wasn't such a big insult not to turn up to meet you at the cinema or whatever. And so there's a kind of dialogue there. So communicative blame can only ever really be the beginning of a dialogue between reasonable persons, but the immediate aim will be characterized in terms of trying to get you to see things more from my point of view so that we come to a shared understanding fairly immediately. But in fact, the shared understanding may be further down the road after a lot more dialogue. Now, one of the interesting things about communicative blame is that when we ask what good does it do, what role does it play in our lives? And of course, I'm asking all these questions in the context of a culture where lots of people have thought blame is really bad. You know, it's just a kind of expression. It's kind of like a sublimated cruelty, and maybe we'd be better off without it. So I'm interested in whether we should be thinking of it in a vindicatory way, and so we look at what use it can do. Now, the way I've described it so far, it's only going to work if people already have a lot of shared values, so that we're basically reminding each other of the shared values we've got. So I do something really shabby to you, and you communicate blame to me to remind me of value, and I immediately say, oh God, I'm sorry, yes, I shouldn't have done that. I wasn't thinking, I didn't realize what a betrayal that would seem like, etc., etc. But can it do anything when people really don't have those shared values, or when something's gone really very wrong in terms of the respect two people may or may not have for each other? Now, Bernard Williams has said some fascinating things about blame in this aspect, and I think Williams actually was very skeptical on the whole about whether blame was useful, but in a few very pregnant paragraphs, as ever, he talks about the proleptic function of blame. And in effect, he's talking about blame that's communicated, so I will allow myself to use my phrase, communicative blame. What's the proleptic function? Well, we've already imagined how it's going to work non-proleptically, as a kind of reminder of shared values. But what if you, let's imagine, so William's example is always the nasty husband. Let's give the nasty husband a break. Let's imagine the really embittered divorcee. She really hates her husband now. Things have had severe moral breakdown between the two of them. And she's treated him very shabbily in some way. Now, he's got pretty low odds of communicating blame to her and getting the shared moral understanding. But all is not lost, so long as she has at least some residual respect, or I think probably more appropriate, might just say just care for how he regards her. And as Williams puts it, so what goes on is that he will blame her for her shabby behavior towards him. And so long as she has this kind of residual respect or care for him, his protestations will have an impact on her psychology and may have a chance of causing her to thereby come to embrace the value or the reason that he's admonishing her for failing to act on. When that happens, if she does then, as it were, move towards him and embrace that reason, what's happened? Well, actually, this is a process of social construction. He's treated her as if she already had recognized a reason or a value that she wasn't recognizing, but has thereby caused her to come to recognize that reason or value. And when that happens, that's exactly a mechanism of social construction. So what I've tried to do is bring out this aspect from Williams's rather sparse comments and say, look, what this reveals is that communicative blame does not only do something useful when we just remind each other that we're falling short of values that are already shared, it actually works when it works proleptically to actively socially construct shared moral values and shared recognition of moral reasons. And that means that it's coming on stage as a kind of, extraordinary morally generative force, a social constructive force. And that looks like something that does amount to a vindication of this kind of blame. So while there might be lots of other kinds of blame, excessive blame or embittered blame, passive-aggressive blame and so on, which we'd be better off without, this kind of blame, the communicative kind which can work as a reminder or proleptically to regenerate and reaffirm shared moral values, looks like it's actually essential to a shared moral life. Not just useful, but essential to bringing each other on board with shared values. And it's going to be particularly obviously at work in times of social transition when people's values are changing. So if we think of an issue that's of social transition at the moment, I suppose something like transgender identity is something that's very much we're in transition about how to talk, how to treat each other and so on. This kind of communicative blame, when we get it wrong, let's remember it need not be of the censorious kind, it can just be almost of the reminder educative kind, is going to be doing so much of the moral work of helping us understand each other better and understand what hurts and what constitutes a wrong and how to come to share a certain conception of how to treat each other as regards gender identity. So that's the sort of argument then that looks like a vindication. And then what I try and do with blame, and I won't trouble you with this today because I want to move on to the forgiveness, is test out that hypothesis to see if this kind of vindicatory story about blame can do useful explanatory work. And in this past work, I've tried to show that indeed it does. But all we need for today, so that it will dovetail with what I want to say next about forgiveness, is the idea that the point of the paradigm case of blame, namely communicative blame, is to inspire remorseful shared moral understanding on the part of the wrongdoer. Okay, that's the bit we need to retain. Now, draw a line onto the forgiveness bit. We're going to apply the method here, and again, we'll put a hypothesis about what the paradigm case of forgiveness is on the table, and then we'll see what explanatory work it can really do for us once we've identified its point or purpose. As I said earlier, forgiveness looks like a really good subject matter for this sort of method because it's, in a certain way, disunified and in disarray. We've got these two very different kinds of forgiveness, earned and unearned, which are puzzlingly, they just look like quite different sorts of practice. Now, where then are we going to begin with our thoughts about what to posit as the paradigm case? Well, we're looking, as ever, for something that's plausibly a necessary feature, growing out of human nature, growing out of the reactive attitude, so that it looks pretty basic and pretty a good candidate for being at core in any of the more culturally contingent versions of the practice. And so if we look at what Strawson says about forgiveness, perhaps that will give us a start. He says, besides resentment and gratitude, I mentioned just now forgiveness. To ask to be forgiven is in part to acknowledge that the attitude displayed in our actions was such as might properly be resented, and in part to repudiate that attitude for the future. And to forgive is to accept the repudiation and to forswear the resentment. Okay, well, when we're putting things forward as good candidates for something more or less humanly necessary, we probably better press it a bit and not just take him at his word, especially since he had slightly different task ahead of him than we do. Is this going to be a suitably minimal, suitably necessary looking reactive attitude for us to work with? I guess the things we should press are that he's using quite explicitly normative language. He could go for a more Humean, merely descriptive sort of language of saying, well, when human beings forgive, we just find that when someone expresses apology or remorse, the feeling of resentment disappears. That would be a more sort of Humean and descriptive way of putting it. I'm not sure I've got a terribly great argument for why I favour the more normative way of putting it than the Humean way, but Don't you think, I mean, what the logic, or if you like, the grammar of these moral emotions seems to me to be built in from the start, that the reason, you know, the kind of emotion that human beings have when they've been hurt and an expression of remorse in the form of apology or whatever it might be is forthcoming, isn't, for a start, certainly isn't an automatic vanishing of the blame feeling. Very often that blame feeling will linger for as long while, which is why Strawson's right to use the word forswear. Forswearing blame feeling is very different from just finding it's disappeared by magic. So what's basic in human nature, I'm suggesting with Strawson, is actually a recognition that continued blame feeling after apology's been forthcoming is no longer appropriate. And so I think he's right to build in the normativity into the emotions themselves rather than to do it in a purely kind of social descriptive way and then find some difficult way of trying to build in the normativity thereafter. But so I'm happy with thinking of these emotions as essentially normative in character. I believe they are. That, as I say, I'm not sure I have a much stronger argument for it than that. What about the way he builds in the future as well as the past here? If we're looking for something kind of minimal and necessary, could there be a human society, a recognizable moral practice where the repudiation on the part of the wrongdoer when she's recognizing that she's done a really morally shabby thing is just orientated towards the past and present and not doesn't involve a kind of commitment not to do it again? Because he talks about repudiating the attitude for the future. Is that too much to ask of something that's necessary? Well, again, I don't think so. Again, if we look at the grammar of the emotions, I don't think I really count as repudiating some shabby action that I've done if I merely confine in a kind of freeze frame way my disavowal of it to the past and to the now, but as it were, I'm just neutral about whether I might do it again tomorrow or next week. That's not a repudiation, right? If we are remorseful for something and we repudiate it, that commits us to a certain general attitude towards it, which is going to stretch both across time and across modal space, as it were, and other imaginable situations. It's not the sort of thing I would do. That's what I mean when I say I'm sorry for it. So once again, I think Strawson's right. Not only is it normative, but it's also future and modality involving, and that's just built into the emotions themselves. So I'm happy. I think this looks like a fair stab at something humanly necessary insofar as we believe in these reactive attitudes at all, which I do, as our clue about what our basic case is. But now if we look at what he's given us already just in those few words, what we find is it is what I'm calling moral justice forgiveness. It is the earned kind of forgiveness, because what's gone on is someone stood on your hand or whatever it might be, and then they've repudiated it, and in their repudiating it, you recognize that continued blame feeling towards them is now inappropriate, and so you forswear it. You might have it lingering for quite some time because we're not perfect, and we need a little bit of time to forgive, but your recognition that continued blame feeling is inappropriate has been secured, and that is exactly what is at work in most people's conception of the earned kind of forgiveness, which I'm calling moral justice forgiveness, because I think it is a kind of broadly justice conception of around the notion of moral desert, that a wrongdoer deserves to be forgiven once he's suitably sorry. So now, if that's our basic case, our paradigm case, it's our candidate at least, let's ask the next step. What's the point of that? What role does moral justice forgiveness play in our lives? Now, what we see is, standing back again, we look at human society and we see how human beings wrong each other quite a lot of the time and then express blame, and the wrongdoer then expresses sorriness in the form of remorse of some kind. What needs to happen is that, as it were, we need a channel for the now redundant blame feeling on part of, let's say, me, the wronged party, to go somewhere, as it were. We don't want it to linger idly in the system. It's not doing any work anymore. Once it's inspired the remorseful understanding in the person who wronged you, then the blame feeling has no further useful, morally positive job to do, and it risks a kind of toxicity if it's allowed to just churn idly in the system. We all know how toxic resentments which aren't doing any moral work can do. They can ruin other relationships besides when, you know, thinking back to our embittered divorcee, think how much embittered divorces can ruin relationships with the children, with other friends around, if the resentments are allowed to linger in the system. We know how toxic this sort of blame feeling can be. And so human societies need a way of dispelling it and making sense of dispelling it. And the ritual, if you like, of remorseful apology and the way that makes that blame feeling now redundant allows for us to get rid of it and make sense of it. And so what I propose is that we think of the point of moral justice forgiveness as the hurt party, or the blamer, if you like, ability to get rid of redundant blame feeling. Because it's done its job. That's why it's redundant. It's already inspired the remorseful apology in the wrongdoer, and so now has no further useful moral work to do, and so it's become redundant. So if we hang on to this phrase, which I'm going to need to do quite a lot of work for me, of liberating the blamer from redundant blame feeling, that's going to be our conception of the point or role of moral justice forgiveness. Now, our question is going to be, as we see if we provide useful explanatory work from this conception, our question is going to be whether the other kind of forgiveness, which we're hoping to explain in relation to this purportedly basic or paradigm kind as a culturally contingent derivation of it, we have to see whether it displays fundamentally the same point and purpose. And if it does display that same point and purpose, that will be added grist to the mill to thinking that it's basically the same sort of practice, but in some interestingly concealed or rearranged formation. Right? And that's basically the conception I'm going to have. We've got this basic case that grows fairly directly out of human nature, the reactive attitudes, and then the gifted kind of forgiveness, which looks superficially so different, is in fact going to turn out to be a rearranged or deconstructed culturally contingent formation of that basic case. And if we can show that, and that it actually does the same basic job, has the same role of freeing the blamer from redundant blame feeling, then we'll have a nice little theory that's hanging together. So let's think about gifted forgiveness. Now, I suppose a pretty famous emblematic case that's often discussed in the literature is the case of the bishop in Victor Hugo's Les Misérables. Many different writers discuss the case, and so I'll join in and use it in an emblematic way. It's a very striking case. The bishop, if you remember, he takes in Jean Valjean, and Valjean tries to make off with the rectory silver the next morning and is caught, and yet the bishop just forgives him without sort of demanding remorse or apology and so on. It's a gifted kind of forgiveness that is forthcoming from the bishop. And no accident, of course, that there's a Christian tradition of forgiveness that's being exemplified here. We recognize that too, though I would never say that gifted forgiveness only is found in Christianity, but in this particular example, it's that form of it that we're observing. So what is this? Some writers have thought that gifted forgiveness just really isn't proper forgiveness. It looks far too close to merely condoning the wrongdoing, hard to really make sense of as justified, and yet it seems to be a very recognizable and in some ways important and widespread practice. So there's a sort of conundrum here. Now, what I want to suggest is that one a useful way of thinking about this kind of forgiveness is to see it, in short, as a kind of proleptic version of moral justice forgiveness. Now, let me explain. What's going on when the bishop just forgives anyway and adopts this stance of non-demand towards the thief who's betrayed his trust and generosity is that there's, instead of demanding the remorse up front as a condition and justification of the forgiveness, which can then be forthcoming so that the blame feeling's rendered redundant in advance, it's done its job, what we see is the bishop treating Valjean as if he were already remorseful, thereby having a decent chance of bringing it about, causally speaking, that Valjean actually retrospectively comes to feel remorseful. And in fact, there's a certain amount of sociological literature which suggests that this works quite well. Certainly as a mother of teenagers, I find that it works better than communicative blame. But of course, it's not going to work all the time, for sure, but nor is moral justice, for goodness, going to work all the time. But there's a decent chance that taking the stance of forgiveness towards someone, understood as treating them as if they're already remorseful, it's a bit like, you know, treating them... looking for their better judgment. You treat them as if, you know, I recognise you're someone who's better than this, who's able to recognise that he shouldn't have made off with the silver. So I'm just going to go direct to that. I'm going to bypass all the communicative blame stuff, which is in any case likely to just entrench things. And I'll just take this stance of non-demand and what? Well, hope. Hope that you might in time come to see the error of your ways and come to feel it. Now, again, as ever, I'm not committed to the idea that the bishop has this in his head as a motive at all. I'm suggesting that we can read, as it were, culturally, practices of gifted forgiveness as proleptic practices of moral justice forgiveness, where both the point of communicative blame, which is to get the shared moral understanding of a remorseful kind on the part of the wrongdoer, and the point of the forgiveness, which is to liberate the potential blamer, the hurt party, from redundant blame feeling, are both achieved at once. For our bishop might fleetingly feel some blame feeling and then get rid of it, or perhaps he's so practiced in the art of gifted forgiving that he doesn't feel the blame feeling at all, and he really does bypass it and go direct to the forgiveness. Well, we're still seeing that this kind of forgiveness is exemplifying the basic same point. The blame feeling he could have felt is redundant because his stance of gifted forgiving is going to achieve the aim of getting shared understanding from Valjean the thief without going through the loop of the communicative blame. And so any blame feeling on the part of the bishop is redundant already, as it were, not because it's already achieved its point, but because it's not needed to achieve the point of communicative blame. So I told you I was going to be hoping to use the word redundant in this slightly elastic way. Something can be redundant because it's already done its job or because it's just not needed to do its job, redundant from the start. So if we read cases, or at least some cases, of gifted forgiveness as proleptic operations of, in effect, moral justice forgiveness, we certainly don't have to think that that motive's in his head, and nor do we have to think that somehow the moral meanings that are at stake when you take up that stance of non-demand towards a wrongdoer are just the same as the moral justice stance. All the psychology and all the culturally generated moral meanings might be really very different from the stance of demand and the stance of justice. There's a real difference between the bishop's open attitude of hope and sort of non-judgmentalness and the more stern sort of censures of an angry fire and brimstone style, as it were, condemner. But looked at as cultural practices of forgiveness, we are seeing nonetheless that the gifted one is growing out of the moral justice one and is in a certain way a disguised, because quasi-deconstructed, version of the paradigm case, because what we're seeing is that the ultimate end of shared moral understanding and liberation of blame feeling on the part of the hurt party are displaced. So the shared understanding is displaced into the future rather than required in the present as a condition of the forgiveness. And that's the way in which a more contingent cultural iteration of the basic practice can be in disguise, because one bit of it is over there in the future and not, as it were, demanded in the present as a condition. Now, a little bit of supplementary argument to back up the thought that the gifted case is explanatorily posterior to the moral justice case, it comes when we think about the meanings. I've got this on the handout. The way I've put it is conceptual and therefore genetic, query, priority. Think about the meanings and values of the gifted forgiveness case. You've wronged someone, and they just take this stance of non-demand to you and forgive you anyway. You're, as it were, shocked into thinking, wow, just forgive me. I didn't even say sorry. I haven't done anything to make up for this. And yet, she's just given me this thing of letting it go. The reason, as I said earlier, that's a shock to the system, and the reason it can be so moving when people really do it and do achieve it, is that it's undeserved. And you can't have that meaning at work in the practice unless we all already think of forgiveness as something that ordinarily needs to be earned or deserved. And that shows that the gifted practice cannot be prior to the moral justice practice. Maybe they could grow up together, but on the whole, I think it really shows, backs up my hypothesis that the moral justice case is not only explanatorily prior, but probably historically prior to the gifted case. And I rather like that, because I always like those little moments in philosophy when it seems like either a purely formal argument, or in this case, a purely conceptual argument about meanings, turns out to have implications for something empirical, namely which thing actually came first. Of course, it might be wrong, but if it's right, then it has got that empirical or historical implication. Okay, so we're having this idea that it's that gifted forgiveness has the shared moral understanding at one remove in the future now in the proleptic form instead of being visible in the present. There's another way of reading gifted cases of gifted forgiveness, and this may often be co-present with the proleptic mechanism, and that is to see a different sort of displacement at work, not this time temporal or modal displacement of the shared understanding that we all seek, but rather that the practice seeks, but rather a social displacement. Now, other sorts of puzzling cases, and some people find them puzzling, others just find them moving, of gifted forgiveness come from serious, real situations which many of us read about and perhaps some are involved in. For instance, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa, or similar sorts of processes where you read these cases of the most appalling murders or abuses, and yet the surviving family members will look to forgive the culprit, even if he's far from remorseful at this moment. And I won't go into, I don't really want to go into examples without giving their proper due. So I merely point you to, for instance, a paper by Lucia Lay, where she discusses a particular case from the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, where the daughter of a man who was murdered in a horrible way asks, and Desmond Tutu says in his writing, you could hear a pin drop in the room. She says, we want to forgive, but we don't know who to forgive. And so she's looking around to find out who the culprit was who murdered her father in order to be able to forgive. Now, many people find these cases puzzling. They're clearly a case of gifted forgiveness, and they're very moving cases. And I certainly wouldn't want to brand them as mere condemnations or a kind of giving up on the business of holding people to justice. But a useful way of seeing them is as a socially displaced kind of moral justice forgiveness, where the kind of shared moral understanding that in moral justice cases we would seek from the culprit as a condition of the forgiveness is present in the community. And in the Truth and Reconciliation cases, it's terribly clearly in the community because it's literally an institutional community who's going ahead with the process. But perhaps it needn't be such a formal community. Perhaps it could be just your immediate ethical community who sees things as you see them, recognizes that you or a member of your family has been gravely wronged. And that might be enough to enable you to gift forgiveness to the culprit, even if he or she is not themselves sharing in that moral understanding or not yet. And I think if what this reveals is if we see it that way, then we've got the second kind of culturally contingent iteration of the basic case of moral justice, where the shared understanding is not temporally displaced, but it's socially displaced instead. And I think in actually lots of these cases, it's sort of both will be going on at the same time. I think that where there are cases of gifted forgiveness that cannot be construed as involving either the temporal displacement of the shared understanding or a social displacement of the shared understanding, then I start to wonder whether they really do hold up as cases of forgiveness, and whether they don't start to look a bit more like a kind of giving up on moral engagement and a mere letting go of some other kind. But I'm not sure about that, but I'm tempted by that thought. Last little set of comments. Am I okay for time? The last little set of thoughts is just further supplementary argument to the effect that this approach does some good explanatory work. So I've tried to suggest that the main job it's doing for us is showing how these very different kinds of forgiveness are in fact of a unified kind, where the gifted kind is turning out to be a temporally or socially displaced version of the more basic kind of moral justice forgiveness, and that the same basic point is being served in all cases, that same basic point being the liberation of the blamer from now redundant or always redundant blame feeling. But can it do us a little bit more good? Some of the pathological or common deformations of forgiveness that writers are correctly concerned about and concerned to avoid might be explained by reference to the proleptic action of forgiveness. So two kinds I just want to focus on are a kind of, it can seem like a kind of spineless, lily-livered, forgiving too easily kind of a practice. And another one can be an over-optimistic, Pollyanna-ish sort of hope that I will get over my blame feeling by pretending I'm getting over my blame thing and really I'm not, and I end up in some kind of passive-aggressive circle of kidding myself that I've forgiven you when really I haven't. And I think both of these phenomena, both of these deformations of forgiveness or sort of pitfalls of forgiveness, if you like, are explained rather well on this model because they're revealed as very likely to grow out of the hopeful proleptic mechanism that's involved. So first of all, think about other directed prolepsis, the kind I've already described where, like, the bishop treats Valjean as if he's already remorseful for what he's done, thereby with a sort of view to his actually becoming remorseful for what he's done. Now, of course, if you really are engaged in a practice where the point is to try and get the person to be remorseful, even if that's not part of your motive, because your own stance is one of just giving, you can be really over-optimistic. You can be going around forgiving people when in fact there's just not a hope in hell they're ever going to get it, and it just gives them a license to carry on doing it. That would be a bad idea. That would be a sort of deformation of the practice on this construal. So, but what we see is that kind of over-optimism is bound to grow out of the leap of hope that any kind of gifting stance requires of us. And so in treating people as if they're already remorseful, that hopeful attitude towards their capacity to indeed feel remorseful in the end is bound to sometimes fall short. And so, so this deformation grows out of an intrinsic aspect of the type of forgiveness that it is. I suppose that's all I really want to say. Similarly, the proleptic mechanism might be applied to oneself, and I haven't talked about this yet, but of course, if you hurt me and I want to forgive you and I forswear my blame feeling towards you, and perhaps I even say, you know, I forgive you and so on, I may be doing so in the hope that by treating myself as if I was already free of the blame feeling towards you, I can thereby more easily cause myself to come to actually relinquish that blame feeling. But of course, self-deception is always possible in these things, and I may just be very wrong. It may be that I'm never going to get over this. So I end up in a kind of spiral of passive-aggressive, I forgive you, but clearly manifesting my continuing anger in all sorts of areas of our relationship or something like that. So I think that passive-aggressive deformation of forgiveness too is very well explained as likely to come up as one of the immediate pitfalls of that grows out of exactly the mechanism that's involved in forgiving others, because we can only forswear and then try to bring our hearts into line with what we recognize is required. And so again, seeing that proleptic mechanisms can work not only in connection with others but in connection with ourselves helps us understand the way in which our forms of gifted forgiveness in particular can be over-optimistic or naive or self-deceived, and that's why we end up sometimes in the messes we get into when we have been too hopeful either about others or about ourselves. So I hope that seems like a little bit of a kind of bonus supplementary argument for what started out as a plumping for a hypothesis, and all the argumentation has really come up after the hypothesis, but the main points, just to resume, are that taking moral justice forgiveness as our paradigm case, where that means the explanatorily basic case, looks like it does a good job of unifying these apparently very disunified two kinds of forgiveness by showing that one is a cultural rearrangement, either in time or social space or both, of the first, and by showing that they both exemplify basically the same point and purpose of liberating the blamer from blame feeling, which is redundant, and which, if it were left in the system, would just become toxic. And then, little kind of bonus explanation at the end, it looks like thinking of forgiveness in this way can explain why we are so prone, as I think we are, to over-optimistic, proleptic attitudes, both towards others and towards ourselves. Thank you very much.
Arthur.
So, two questions. I suppose you would agree with the first point, which is whether or not we need to forgive is contingent. We may actually not want to reestablish reciprocal relations with someone. And presumably there are a class of cases about which that's true. And you're not denying that, just you're talking about the class of cases where we do need eventually to forgive, and you're setting out. So is that right?
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And now the question. So I'm thinking of a way in which gifted forgiveness can misfire. So it can misfire this way: if my original blame is mistaken. And so, but instead of engaging in blame, I preempt that by engaging in gifted forgiveness. And now I leave you completely mystified, because I've gifted forgiveness on you for something that you don't think needs it. And now you get angry at me, or you resent me for this, you know, gratuitous gifted forgiveness. So I could see how the practice of gifted forgiveness is much more likely to misfire than the what you say is the original, which I find rather persuasive, the original practice of justice-based forgiveness, because it short-circuits the moral deliberation. That's the whole point of this anyway.
Yes. Thank you very much. I really like the example. Yeah, So that seems right to me, that because the gifted case, certainly as I've described it, seems to involve a lot less dialogue and shared understanding before the forgiveness is forthcoming, that there's a lot of scope for, you can imagine really annoying versions of it, very sort of holier than thou, I forgive you, even though you know. I think that's right. I'd love it if I could kind of spin that to my particular advantage, but at least it's not a disadvantage. But I think that's true. The ways in which, one of the interesting things about forgiveness is that it, we often think of it as involving absolutely no censure, and I guess the attitude does not involve censure, but of course it implies that someone's blameworthy for what they've done. And that's always going to be the part of the sort of passive-aggressive phenomenon I only very briefly described. It's often that, isn't it, that you go directly to forgiveness to be all magnanimous, and really the whole point of expressing the forgiveness was really to say you were blamed for what you did. And so I think there's all sorts of ways in which the rather unspoken forum in which gifted forgiveness will happen can lead to annoying, holier-than-thou type situations and as it were, sublimated accusation. Thank you.
Imagine you go up to the brown sweater. I'm sorry, I don't know your name. That's you. Yeah.
I have a question about your method.
Thank you. So I guess another way one could give an account of blame or of forgiveness is just to try and give necessary and sufficient conditions for the concept. And so I guess I was wondering, as particularly in your account of blame, whether you were seeing this sort of genealogical story as itself a way of then providing necessary and sufficient conditions for the concept of blame or forgiveness, or whether that was like not your project at all.
Thank you. It's not my project, but I'm really interested in the reasons why it might not be my project and why. So in general in philosophy, I'm among those who in the past have sort of expressed a bit of I'm being a bit fed up with a sort of obligatory analysis, and it does tend to happen, even when people say they're not putting forward analysis, the way the discussion goes, people seem to still come up with counterexamples. So we kind of get sucked into doing the analysis business even when we don't want to. But I think genuinely now, so many people, especially in connection with blame and forgiveness, are not trying to give an analysis, that I think that literature is really remarkably freed up from the obligation to. But it's not, for me, in certainly, I haven't thought carefully enough about forgiveness in connection with the business of analysis, but certainly in connection with blame. In this work on blame I did explicitly say I'm not going in for analysis, but it wasn't because I thought no analysis was available or would be forthcoming, or because I thought, so comparing the knowledge case, and in fact Edward Craig's book has an argument for why there could never be an analysis of the concept of knowledge. And part of what inspires his interest in looking for a practical explication, as he calls it, of the concept of knowledge instead of analysis, is because of being fed up with this, the tedium of endlessly going on and counterexamples and patching up your definition. All the reasons many people got fed up with epistemology. But not so in this case. And so I came to think, tell me whether you think this is true, that when the phenomenon a philosopher wants to try and understand or illuminate is itself pretty disunified. So there's lots of different types of things. And that's often going to be true of practices that have evolved through history and cultural change. If there is an analysis to be had, and there might well be, you know, a couple of things that are true of every instance of blame, they're very likely to be really very boring and very minimal and to not do anything very much for us philosophically. Because if we want to explain a phenomenon, lots of explanatorily interesting features are quite likely not to be quite necessary conditions. Why would we expect them to be present in every single possible case of blame? So the worry is that it's just not a very good bet when you're interested in a disunified kind of phenomenon to start by trying to rule out all the features that aren't in every single case, because it might well be that some of the most explanatorily rich features have fallen away through history and are no longer part of the core, but are now looking peripheral. So it was for that reason that I favoured this different methodology, not because I think that there couldn't be an analysis of what it is for A to blame B for doing something.
Hi, it was fascinating. I want to ask about a specific question about the function of forgiveness. You say that it has, or the role, to dissipate the redundant blame on the part of the wrong person who's saying someone else did something wrong. That sounds a bit odd to me, because it would seem that it has more of a role in dissipating the remorse of the individual who has wronged, right? And very often people will want to be forgiven because otherwise they retain this sense of remorse. Now, you retain the knowledge that you were at fault and that you're blameworthy and all those other things that are required. But and it seemed to me that that was more the function of forgiveness than dissipating the blame feeling. And that might explain why people will give unearned forgiveness, because if someone knows that they have already been forgiven, all right, first of all, they're less defensive about admitting they're wrong. Being blamed may lead to defensiveness and a refusal to accept a certain norm, that you didn't actually violate it, rationalization and so forth. If you've already been forgiven, it's easier to, you're assured of forgiveness, to accept your fault, and it dissipates the remorse. So I would give a different analysis of what's going on here, and I'm just wondering whether you find fault with, blame me, don't blame me, for this alternative.
Yes, thank you very much. Yes, so I absolutely share the intuition that, if one looks at practices of forgiveness, the relieving the culprit from her suffering from having done a bad thing is a really important feature of it. And I felt slightly, not disappointed, but slightly surprised that when I started applying my method to forgiveness that I came across something that looked like a plausible case of a basic role in our lives before I even got to the business of relieving the culprit from her bad feeling, her feeling of self-blame about the issue. And so it definitely needs to be fitted in somewhere. But applying the method, of asking what role does forgiveness play in our lives? The first thing I find is what I've given today, that it relieves the blamer and so on. I think there's a certain amount of real experience that one can draw on to substantiate this idea that it's not just a kind of individualistic fantasy on my part, that I'm excessively focused on the wronged party who needs to be relieved of her blame. So, for instance, the Holocaust survivor, Ava Kaur, who I think was recently in a slightly controversial situation because she travelled over, there was one of the accountant guard at Auschwitz. Ava Kaur had been a prisoner in Auschwitz, and indeed her twin had died at Auschwitz. And one of the guards was now being on trial, and she went over to Europe to express forgiveness towards him. And I think he actually sort of embraced her, and she was taken somewhat by surprise, and the whole thing went on Facebook and things, and it was very unfortunate. She was saying, I went to forgive, not to embrace this man. And what I believe about forgiveness and what I teach about forgiveness, she said, was that when you're harmed and severely harmed, someone takes your power away from you, and in forgiving, you can take it back. And she teaches people who are trying to forgive grave wrongs done against them to even write a letter of forgiveness, but never to send it, to keep it to themselves, to keep that power. And I was interested when I heard this mere anecdote on it, that I think it substantiates somewhat that there is a real job that forgiveness does, which doesn't yet involve the release of the culprit from his bad feeling, but is already doing a useful job for us just in terms of the hurt party being released. But what I, just to finish,
it doesn't sound normatively justified
at all. Let me just finish. So, but what I absolutely agree about is that close, not at core therefore, but very close to core, are these other values and functions that forgiveness does, which are the most salient one is indeed the one you point out, which is relieving the culprit from his suffering of being.
This makes it seem as if normatively, if someone really doesn't deserve to be forgiven, ought not to be given it earned or
gifted,
unforgivable. Mm-hmm. Okay, that somebody might say to themselves, but you know, I really should forgive him because I'll feel so much better. I mean, this is not a psychological tool for making yourself feel one way or another. It's something that has to have a normative justification. It may be justified by some of the things you mentioned, but it can't just be a means of self-therapy.
Yeah. Well, so remember, I'm not saying at all that any of this is present in the motives or the reasons in the mind of the forgiver. It's what you see in terms of the overall rationale or function of the practice. But I am committed to the idea, I suppose, that overall function, it's not really overall, that underlying role or function will be intelligibly related to the sorts of reasons people have for forgiving. And funnily enough, I mean, I may be too heterogeneous in my view of what sorts of reasons are decent reasons to forgive for your taste, but I actually think that people often rightly say about why they wanted to forgive someone, they say things that are really quite prudential sounding, quite self-care type of reasons. So they say things like, I just had to forgive him because I didn't want to be this angry person anymore. And I think that is a good reason to forgive. And people do often say those things, but you may well not share that intuition, but I suppose I hope that this setup... I hope that this setup gives some reason of support to the idea that the reasons to forgive are actually much more heterogeneous than is often thought.
Okay, so I was wondering about whether it's possible, whether it can be possible and appropriate to forgive, oneself. On your view, how your view would understand that, because. I mean, it seems like the purpose of, one of the purposes of forgiveness is to, on your view, sort of extirpate redundant blame feelings and to create a shared moral understanding. But it seems like in the case of oneself, you know, at least in certain standard cases, you know, I already share a moral understanding with myself and whatever sense we can make of that phrase. So I'm wondering how to understand that and whether it's going to end up being just not forgiveness at all, or just like a degenerate case of it. I was wondering if you had thoughts about that.
Thank you very much. Yes, self-forgiveness is a fascinating phenomenon, and many people have been just suspicious of it. I mean, Hannah Arendt just thought it couldn't really make sense because you need two poles for the, you know. I think it really can make perfect sense if we think of it on the moral justice model, because I can recognize about myself that I did a shabby thing and I'm now sufficiently sorry about it that I can let it go. I don't have to carry on beating myself up about it. That's broadly the model of moral justice forgiveness, and there's no obstacle for that being applied reflexively, it seems to me. What's interesting is certainly gifted forgiveness makes no sense at all when applied to oneself. I think, oh, well, I did this terrible thing. I love the idea of this reflexive edge, but clearly it doesn't make any sense because one can't do anything proleptic to oneself of that kind. I mean, you can behave as if something is the case and thereby come to approximate it, but in the case of where it's forgiveness, I don't think one can do it. And I think the fact that it's... The reflexive, self-applied moral justice case is coherent, but the gifted reflexive case isn't, adds a certain sort of support to the idea that the moral justice case is the more basic one. The reactive attitudes, as Strawson describes them, of course, are intrinsically the sort of thing which can be applied vicariously. So even if we learn them first through second personal responses, so I learn the way I've got to set up if I harm you and you communicate your blame to me, I actually learn about self-blame through recognizing this second personal case. But those reactive attitudes in general are the sorts of things that can apply to anyone, so they can be applied to oneself. And so it fits with the reactive attitude starting point to think that at least some of them can be reflexively applied. And in the moral justice case, it can, but... we've got far enough away from this basic human natural set of responses by the time we get to gifted forgiveness that it's no longer surprising that it has lost that capacity to be applied reflexively. So I think I'd like to think it sort of grist to my mill that we find the self-forgiveness case can only really work coherently in the moral justice basic form.
I'm curious about, I have a question about your method, which then relates to substance. You started with moral justice forgiveness and posited it as the paradigmatic case, and then sort of tested it, right, in relation to the gifted forgiveness. And you concluded that given what you saw as the function of moral justice forgiveness, and then you saw that function at work also in the gifted forgiveness, that reinforced your sense that moral justice forgiveness was in fact truly paradigmatic, and that the function that you identified for it was a plausible function for forgiveness. But what if you had actually started with gifted forgiveness as the tested paradigmatic case, where I think that the function, I can imagine that the function of gifted forgiveness is prolepsis, right? It is the act of teaching he or she who is forgiven about their state of blameworthiness, right? And so although you describe that sort of proleptic act as parasitic on the moral justice forgiveness, because it's the surprise, oh my gosh, you've forgiven me before I've repented, right? Rather, I think this is inherent in, say, the Christian notion of forgiveness, right? It's that God's love is always there. And that in itself, although you deride this as sort of holier than thou, right? That in itself is actually the proleptic sort of reaching out to say, come and discover, right? You know, how you can blame yourself, right? Why you are worthy of blame, but also worthy of forgiveness. And I think about, say, the response of the many of the families of the victims in the massacre in the church, right? In Charleston. Where they forgave, it was gifted forgiveness. And that I think one way to understand their gifted forgiveness was as an act of proleptic forgiveness. They knew that the shooter, right, that Dylan Roof, was not going to express remorse anytime soon. And this was sort of an ultimate act of prolepsis. And under that, then, you could see moral justice forgiveness as actually being parasitic in that it's when you don't trust that the act of gifted forgiveness is itself going to be sufficiently pedagogical that you say, well, let me walk you through this, right? That you sort of withhold the gifted forgiveness and you do this sort of parasitic step-by-step thing. Let me explain to you why you are blameworthy and get you to accept it and then express your remorse, and now I will assign you forgiveness. But over time, we can actually get to this more paradigmatic case. Whether or not that is a sort of is a correct assessment of the function of forgiveness, part of what I want to do is then suggest that your method, like, you know, if one could sort of spell that out, right, then the method is rather perplexing, because I was able to take a different starting point, make it my paradigmatic case, discover a function for that paradigm that I could then apply to this secondary case and say, oh, good, that reinforces the idea that gifted forgiveness is the paradigm with this role. But now I'm sort of lost in this ambiguous state of, I have my explanation starting from B, you have your explanation starting from A, and how do we resolve those two?
Yes, thank you very much. Yes, it is perplexing. And so I suppose I've got two sort of background implicit methodological principles going, which may not be right, I don't know, but let's make them explicit and we'll see. One is that it's at least very likely that the more basic case will be the simpler, more spelled out one, rather than the, as it were, virtuoso, which a gifting case is, where all sorts of normative stuff is sort of implicit and you're going direct to the outcome. So whether that's very, you know, convincing or not, I don't know, but I think it would be harder to argue that the kind of virtuoso case comes first, and then the kind of plodding, let me walk you through this case, is afterwards. It seems much more likely that human practices build up from something plodding to something more virtuoso. Once the meanings are in place and society evolves its practices, you can get more and more packed into a gesture or an exchange rather than the other way around. So that's one point about complexity, I suppose. You expect complexity to increase rather than to decrease. The other is that if one were to try and run the story your way round, one would need to, at least the way I've got it, I suppose this reveals that, perhaps it reveals that it is a good thing I'm fairly closely wedded to the Craig and Williams thing of starting with something plausibly necessary. It looks a much more plausible claim about human necessity that the kind of reactive attitudes thing, you step on my hand, I'm kind of angry and push you away, whatever it might be, that's where we begin from in human relations and we get more sophisticated, more impartial from there, rather than we start in our simple moral society with this capacity to forgive anyway and then work up from that. I would just find that very hard to defend. I suppose that's a conception of the human reactive attitudes and human nature, which is taken as the starting point. So I think those two things are the two arguments I've got for running it one way rather than the other.
Potentially an ethic, a feminist ethic, right, and one that say sees the mother-child relationship as the sort of, you know, fundamental relationship, might say the mother doesn't push the child
yes.
away.
Right? Yes.
Yes. I'm one more question.
Oh, okay. Well, that's really interesting. Yeah, I don't. There's lots of giving which isn't gifting. Is the only thing I'd want to say. I wouldn't want to put all giving into the. Yeah.
And so at this point, I hope all of you who have been waiting patiently have all already proleptically forgiven me for not calling on you. But I'm going to take somebody who put his hand up right at the very beginning of the question session.
I'm going to change my question around and follow up a little bit on Francis's question and maybe try and help you out. So 2 points. First, it seems like you actually formulated the point of moral justice and forgiveness two slightly different ways. So sometimes you said it's to release the wrong party from blame feeling that no longer serves any point or purpose.
Uh-huh.
And sometimes you like implicitly switched that to releasing the wrong party from blame feeling that no longer serve its point or purpose.
Right.
Where the its is about, you know, the purpose of inspiring remorse and creating understanding. And at first I was thinking, you did it, the its, but the any maybe seemed more plausible because in some cases, like, there's some minor transgression, there's all this other stuff going on we got to deal with. I just forgive you for it, even though you haven't, you know, let's just move on.
Yeah.
And then also the case you brought up with her, where people were just, you know, it's just eating away at me, and I forgive you, you know, because it's not serving any purpose, not because it served its purpose. So switching to the any and being consistent about that might help with that. I mean, now Francis finds that implausible in some cases. But.
Yes.
And then about the point of like the release, the wrong party or the culprit. So I started thinking about third party cases. So I think a lot of times we blame people on behalf of other people. I mean, maybe it's a sort of secondary form of blame, but we do it a lot of times, right? Like you wrong my friend and I blame you for it.
Yeah.
But I don't think I can forgive you. You know, it's only the person that's wrong that can forgive you.
Mm-hmm.
But if it were all about relieving the remorse of the culprit, it might seem like I can forgive you, especially if the culprit is properly remorseful and so
mm-hmm.
on.
Mm-hmm.
But if you make it about releasing the wrong party from the blame feeling, then that might actually explain why only the person wrong can forgive. Mm-hmm. It's a suggestion.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, these going backwards, these issues of standing I find really difficult. I partly find them difficult because I seem to have really weird intuitions compared to lots of other people. Well, Glenn Pettigrove is someone who's written about this, and my intuitions are much closer to his, which is that you know, we can certainly forgive. I can forgive him for hurting her and so on. Now, I imagine someone's been mean to my daughter. I was going to make her a child. She is a child. But let's imagine she's a grown-up, and she's at work, and someone's behaved really badly towards her at work, and I know the person, and I recognize that they're sorry. And I might forgive him before even she can forgive him. But you're looking very pained.
I don't know if I agree.
I suspect that the reason at least I and some others have this intuition is because there's a bit of confusion about whether one's talking about the attitude of forgiveness, mm-hmm. which is basically, I think, an emotional thing, or wading in feet first and saying stuff. It seems to me that very likely communicated forgiveness will track communicative blame in the business of standing. So I think of blaming as something completely kind of universal. I can blame anyone for anything. I see that they're to be blamed for something. And I, as it were, that's how I perceive the moral situation. But communicating the blame and doing some moral work and digging in and sort of getting them to try and change their attitudes and so on, that's something that I need to have a certain sort of proper participatory role in the business to be entitled to do. And so the business of communication is very different from the business of the attitudes in blame, and similarly in forgiveness. So I think maybe the difference of intuitions will slightly go away once we make that distinction. I'm not sure that's entirely answered that last bit, but thank you for the helpful thought. So I don't know how much I can use it to help me with Francis, but anyway, I'll hang on to it. The other thing, the first thing you said about its point and any point, I'm sure my equivocation there is because I continue to be worried about something. I think I probably need to confine my talk about the point of forgiveness to, or the point of blame in particular, to its proper point, because there can be all sorts of rather useful things that a bit of an angry attitude towards someone's can do. As some people have pointed out to me, and if you're just kind of a blamey person that carries some blame with you against this person and that person, you might compete better in certain sorts of situations where they're involved because you really just don't want to let them be. It might be advantageous to have that gritty edge, but I don't really want to start saying that's a good reason. You know. So it's to do with its proper point. So I'm inclined to think I probably better be careful about sticking to its proper point in most of these cases rather than any point. But that's a more general normative worry.
Francis is not going to. It's not clear that it serves proper point.
There is no response.
I'm afraid we have to conclude.
Thank you.
Thank you.